here at the Honomolino unit of the Kona Hema Preserve, managed by the Nature Conservancy. A large part of their operations is to try to regenerate young koa forests in this unit. This area was once grazed by cattle, and as we can see is dominated by a number of exotic grass species, including a bromus species and also the infamous kikuyu grass. Today I'm going to demonstrate the use of herbicides for trying to suppress some of the competition this grass creates. And the three treatments that we're looking at are glyphosate, which is a broad-spectrum herbicide, Fusilade, which is a grass-selective herbicide, and Imazapyr, which is considered to be a broad spectrum, but we've recently determined that koa is resistant to the Imazapyr, while the Penicetum species, including kikuyu grass, are highly sensitive to Imazapyr. So in this case, we have selectivity with the Imazapyr as well. Here we're looking at a close-up view of the grass stand at the soil surface, and as you can see as I put my hand down, the thatch level is pretty substantial. This probably represents close to 10 to 15 tons per hectare of biomass, which creates a significant amount of shade and competition in this environment, which is probably why we don't see natural regeneration of koa from the seed bank, even though we know a seed bank's there, which is why we employ scarification in this system. Scarification gives us excellent germination in this site. However, the grass does re-encroach and reoccupy this site, creating further competition against the koa and any other native species. What we're looking at here is how scarification is an excellent technique for germinating young koa from the seed bank that is established in this soil. However, what we also see is that scarification is a poor technique for grass control. So what we're looking at 3 months after scarification is grass competition against these young seedlings.
This is where post-scarification herbicide applications can be very important when trying to establish these young koa. Here I am spraying Imazapyr at 1 quart per acre using the hands-free backpack sprayer with a flood jet tip. Notice the wide swath I'm able to create, allowing me to cover a lot of ground.
This scarified site is even too difficult for vehicles to access, so the only way to apply herbicides is by foot with a backpack sprayer. This is where the hands-free technology of spraying herbicides has great utility in these types of situations. Because of the hands-free opportunities, I have my ability to keep balance and focus on the terrain that I'm trying to access, knowing that behind me, the herbicides are being applied in an effective and efficient manner. So within the Imazapyr plot, at 4 months after application, we can see that we have excellent desiccation of the grass biomass. And while we do have some green tissues remaining, these green tissues show a very typical symptom of Imazapyr with necrotic lesions, which suggests that the herbicide is still active. Here we show how kikuyu grass and Yorkshire fog show the similar symptomology of necrotic lesions. So here we're within the glyphosate plot, again at 4 months after treatment application, and you'll see how glyphosate also did an excellent job of desiccating the grass biomass. Well, there's also green tissues within this treatment plot, but these green tissues are new regrowth, suggesting that the herbicide no longer has activity. Here within the Fusilade plot, we show that the level of suppression is much less than the glyphosate and Imazapyr. Now, Fusilade is a really valuable herbicide in these operations because of its selectivity, but in this area, we definitely did not have the same level of activity. So here we are on a return visit to our scarification demonstration site. As you can remember, 4 months prior, we had germinated koa seedlings and a well-established grass that was out-competing this young seedling population. And so we proceeded by applying Imazapyr with the hands-free backpack sprayer. And as you can see, we are starting to get really good suppression of the grass. But when I look around me, all of the koa are surviving, thus showing that koa has really good tolerance to the Imazapyr. So here you see a young koa seedling that survived the spray, and notice again the necrotic lesions on the grasses showing that the selectivity of the herbicide. So here we have another excellent example of the selectivity imazapyr shows, where Koa is doing really well and the grasses are on the decline. We're in June, so we're coming into the summer season where the trees should be actively growing, and now would they have a chance to grow without competition this summer. So we're really looking forward to seeing how the trees respond to this suppression strategy. Previously we showed how Koa is resistant to the imazapyr, but not all of our native species are. Here we show in a directed application around the base of this ohia, any contact that the herbicide made resulted in injury and death to this foliage. However, we do see as we pan up that the ohia will survive. It is not a lethal dose, but we do have to be mindful in our directed applications in and around ohia and probably other natives as well. Here's an example where Fusilade works really well on cucuyu grass as an understory species. Notice how much taller this grass stands with a greater foliar fraction, able to absorb a significant amount of the herbicide that was applied. And of course, the greatest utility of Fusilade is its selectivity. And of course, this is what we want to see when we suppress the grasses, is natives recolonizing these areas. And so hopefully we'll see more of this fern activity, some of the dyschampia, and of course the koa, ohia, and some of the other native species in this area.